I'm Marshall Herskovitz, and I am a writer, producer, director, and sometimes actor, who's been at this way too long. I came to Los Angeles in the 1970s and have found a way to fit in this business ever since in all sorts of guises. I started out in television. I was a freelance writer for shows and then became a producer and then started writing for movies and started directing movies and at the same time doing television shows. So it's been kind of an eclectic bunch of things over the years. You know, it's funny, I see myself as a filmmaker. It's hard for me to delineate between the writing, the producing, and the directing. I don't direct movies anymore, but that's my choice because it was basically too crazy making. And I just found it wasn't fun for me. I still love directing, but I only do it in television. So I like to produce the things that I make, but I also like to write them. You know, whatever creative process I can be a part of, that's what I like. So I would say right now it's as much writing as it is producing. You know, it's interesting. Antiheroes came on the scene in movies back in the 1960s and 1970s, and it took television a very long time to catch up. But the idea of an antihero is not new. And I think for us, when we were working in television in the 1980s, when we were doing 30-something, the idea of having main characters on a television show who were flawed, who made mistakes, who were sometimes screwed up or not even nice people, seemed revolutionary in television, but for movies was not. I mean, I think much of what we did in 30-something was really bringing the sensibility of filmmaking into the world of television. You know, we live in such an amazing moment in television right now, it's sometimes hard to remember back to the time when people said television was the great wasteland, and it really was. You know, when you look at what was on television in the 60s and 70s, even though there were shows that I liked, that I enjoyed watching, they didn't really have much to do with life. You know, they didn't really sort of act as an exploration of sort of what it means to be a human being, like the movies that were being made in the late 60s and early 70s, Coming Home and Bonnie and Clyde and The Wild Bunch and so many amazing films. It was like a golden age of movies at that time. But it took television a long time to catch up. And that's really what we were doing in 1987 and 30-something, was just bringing that sensibility. So a lot of that had to do with saying, well, what does it mean to be the main character of a story? Why does that mean you have to be a hero? And what is a hero? And I think even the idea of an anti-hero is really just a pigeonhole for a person who's complex, who has different motives, who's ambivalent, you know, who wants to be one way but also wants to be another way. You know, when we created 30-something, we didn't actually do a Bible for the show as people talk about Bibles. When we started to do 30-something, we wrote a few paragraphs kind of expressing what we thought the show was about. And one of the things we said was it was about ambivalence. You know, you're in your 30s, you know it's time to grow up, but you still feel like a kid. You're married and you love your wife, but you're attracted to other women. You know, you want to express yourself in your work in some way that's passionate, but you know you need to make money. That these conflicts of life are really what it's like, what it means to be an adult. So that's not really an anti-hero, but a lot of people interpret it that way. When I first got to Los Angeles, it really was a slow-moving town. People drove slowly. You would meet these producers, and they really did have year-round tans, and they really would hang around their pool reading scripts all day. And it was not a very high-pressure environment. And it's amazing to me now when I think about what we've become. But also, look, the business was always corporate, but the corporate mindset was not how the business was run. The business was still run in the 1970s by a group, almost entirely men, who were in many ways mavericks, still, who bet on their gut and who were passionate about movies and had relationships with filmmakers. And you could still think about making movies in terms of what stories meant something to you as a filmmaker. You could be an artist. Now, it doesn't mean you didn't have to in some way deal with the marketplace, but there was a big intersection between art, passion, and that which was commercial. And I think you know, over the years, for a lot of reasons we don't need to get into here, I think that balance has shifted, especially in the movie business, for sure, toward commerce. And it's very, very hard today to be an artist and a filmmaker in Hollywood. You can do it if you make indie films. It's almost impossible to do it if you make studio films. And that's just where we are. I think also we've seen that corporations and the sort of corporate philosophy of how you run a business has finally and completely taken over Hollywood. And decisions are made as to what kind of business they want to be in, what kind of movies they want to make, what kind of television shows they want to make, in ways that are indistinguishable from how cars are made or how Apple decides to make products or any other large corporation. And, you know, you can rail about that, but I think that's the world we live in now. And so, you know, things are so different. First of all, this idea of a brand, this idea that every single outlet, every single network has to have a brand is so different from the old days. When we first started doing television, I thought of the networks kind of as these big department stores where you could go and find anything you wanted, you know, the variety shows and comedy shows and serious shows and silly shows, and they kind of prided themselves on that. And it's the opposite now. Every single network has this very narrow view of how they want to be perceived in the marketplace. So, you know, as filmmakers, as artists, as writers, you have to accommodate yourself to this specificity. And so there's an irony with, you know, there must be, I don't know, 40 networks making scripted television right now, but it's still difficult to sell because it's such a narrow target for each one. You know, I'm of two minds on the changes in distribution and television, and can't even call it television anymore, and the internet and streaming. On the one hand, I'm for anything that democratizes the landscape. I'm for anything that breaks up the power of the very large companies who have dominated television, especially since 1995 when the FinCEN rules were thrown out and all of a sudden the networks became all powerful. Or shall I say, the five corporations that owned those networks became all powerful. On the other hand, I am worried about what's going to happen to revenue in whatever you want to call it, television, streaming, you know, this thing we watch, you know, that comes into our homes. You know, the Malthusian idea that somehow, you know, you reach a point where there are just too many people out there making content and there's just not enough money to go around, I think will have a real effect. And I don't mean in terms of money we get paid. I mean in terms of money available to make the product. That's what I worry about. I worry that there just won't be enough of a stream coming in to a particular network because of the fragmentation of how these distribution models get sort of pushed out into the world, that the business model will collapse on itself. I do worry about that. As much as I worry about piracy and illegal downloading and the hundreds of ways in which content is being devalued in the culture. You know, there is this strange corollary to the world we live in now, to the effect of the internet, which is that the internet, for all of the amazing, wonderful things it's brought us, is really destroying intellectual property. It's destroying the value, the monetary value of intellectual property. And when it does that, it destroys the ability of people to pursue it as a profession. And what you get then is the amateurizing of professions. You're already seeing that in photography. Professional photographers can't make a living anymore, and everyone thinks they can be a photographer because their cameras are so sophisticated they can point and shoot and have good images. But in fact, we still need professional photographers. So what do we do about the fact that they can't make a living? You know, journalism, magazines, you know, book publishing, you know, across the board, you know, the music business decimated by the internet, and it's about to happen to us in Hollywood. You know, any moment now, it could go from the rather large trickle that it is in the United States. By the way, in Southeast Asia, it's already, you know, a flood. But in the United States, it could get that bad at any moment, where all of a sudden, a third of your revenue is lost to piracy or illegal downloading. you know, file sharing sites, whatever it is, that's a big fear. So I think the idea of holding on to revenue so that we can keep making a product that's worth watching is a big deal, and it's something we all need to be concerned about. Well, I think the PGA is way ahead of the curve in terms of what's happening, especially, and in particular, the new media council. I mean, I think this is what these folks do for a living, and what they're saying, which I think is so important, is that the power must reside with the creator. You know, these are the producers of that content. It's not the corporations who dictate, you know, what they should do. The new media council is made up of people who are trying to figure out what these new models are going to be and try to make sure that the producer of any, you know, piece of content, wherever it is, however it's distributed, is the one who's going to gain and is going to be able to keep doing what he or she does for a living. Again, that's the key part of this. It's not about getting rich. It's about, is there enough revenue in the business model to make sure that you can make the kind of quality that we need? It's very important for people to understand, you know, there's a whole range of filmmaking that you can find on YouTube right now. Anybody can make a movie. You know, you can take your iPhone and make a movie. You know, you can make a movie for no money. You can make a movie for $10 or $20. What is it that makes something professional? And is there a minimum amount of budget necessary for something to be professional? The answer is yes. I don't know exactly what that number is, but it has to do with who's working on it. You know, who's the art director? Who's the costumer? How many days did you take to do it? You know, what level of professionalism were the actors, the writer, all those things? It all takes money. And I think people tend to think, oh, well, they're just greedy in Hollywood, that sort of thing. I'm not even talking about the people at the top who make millions of dollars a year. I'm talking about a living wage for the, what they call below the line people who make these shows, to be able to pay, be paid in such a way that you're making something that's professional, because finally that's what the audience wants. You know, for me, the best part of being the PGA is just getting to know other producers. You know, the first meeting I went to, I realized, oh, this is a bunch of people sitting around a table who are not egotistical, they don't need to hear themselves talk, they just want to get the problem solved, because that's what producers are. And It's been a wonderful thing for me to get to know producers at every different, you know, aspect of this business. And I think one of the key things the PGA can offer its members is this connection with other members. You know, people just starting out, people at the top, people over the hill, whatever it is, sharing what their experiences are. This idea of sharing experience has turned out to be an amazing thing for every producer I know in the PGA.
Hey, ladies and gentlemen, welcome.
Hello.
We start in a second, please. Thank you, Carl. We're kind of warming you guys up for Marshall Herskovitz.
Yeah, great.
You didn't say that right?
What?
Marshall Herskovitz.
Correct.
Okay, great.
Thank you, Sean Gold.
So,
I know. I wasn't going to go that far.
We're going to do a little housekeeping here. Welcome to the Digital VIP Salon Series. We bring on people who have advanced storytelling in some way to share their perspective and sort of hopefully motivate people in the room. Marshall is someone who has changed storytelling in many ways, adding meaningful messages and making people real. But we're not introducing him yet. I kind of get mad when they try to sneak like product placements into events, but it's kind of pointless because it's just going to happen. And trying to escape them is like trying to find another TV with the same clarity and resolution as the world's first curved UHD TV.
That's
pretty good, Sean.
Thank you.
Yeah.
You want to introduce the other?
I guess. Yeah. Can I? You know. You did all right, but I think you didn't deserve this award. I'll be right back. All right. So, thank you, Co-Chair Sean Gold, and I want to thank the committee
who's helped put the Digital VIP Salon Series together, and of course, Soho House, who's been hosting us now for 2 years. So if everybody could give a round of applause for Soho House.
You're here.
It's really been great to us. And obviously, for those of you that are not familiar with Digital VIP, it stands for Digital Visionaries, Innovators, and Producers. And of course, Sean will continue to introduce Marshall. But just on a personal note, to give a little more Marshall praise, I remember when I first joined the Producers Guild many, many years ago in a land far, far away called New York City. And at that time, Marshall was the president of the Guild. And I remember my first time meeting him, and it was in Los Angeles at a actually New Media Council meeting, of which it was one of the first NMC meetings. And he was, and still has been to this day, the only president that's ever sat in a New Media Council board meeting. And I remember it distinctly because I said to myself, well, here is the bridge. Here's a gentleman who's extremely accomplished in film and television, just an all-around great guy. And he really supported, hey, don't laugh, I'm being sincere here. Give me my moment. You get your microphone back. And truthfully, if it wasn't for Marshall, I don't think the New Media Council would have gotten the traction that it did so early on, just because of your support of it. Because, come on, let's face it. It was a bunch of film dudes hanging around going, what is digital? And you may not have understood completely what it was, but at least you said, hey, this is something we got to focus on and pay attention. So I want to thank you for that.
Cheers.
Yeah. And back to housekeeping.
He was like, I could use this in a script.
Okay. I hope he does. Just make sure I get my royalty checks. So yes, we've done the Samsung plug. Now we're going to move on to some of our other wonderful sponsors that Diane Salerno has secured for the series. And she's our sponsorship director at the Guild. So I'm just going to read these because they were written for me. It's Box, which is a wonderful company, is the leading cloud content management platform offering secure storage, sharing, file sync, collaboration, and workflow on all of your devices. That's pretty cool.
That's
huh?
a pretty shitty.
That's yeah. That's a terrible thing to have, but it's a good thing to have.
So Josh Klein is the guy who's kind of running Box in Hollywood. Awesome guy.
Awesome
Box
guy.
Is trying to build like all kinds of process management stuff to make producing easy. Yeah. So if you see him and you're using it, like, and you have issues with it, definitely give him a shit.
Send him an email and thank him for sponsoring tonight's wine and booze and all that other kind of stuff. 4WT Media is a next generation production company and video agency specializing in creating high impact. I want to say that again, high impact content for brands and advertisers. And there's the guy right there. So if you want to have some high-impact conversations, talk to him.
I'll do final draft.
No, that's my fun part. You okay. get to introduce Marshall. Come on. Final draft. We all know what final draft is, right? It makes writing screenplays easy. Final draft, known as the industry standard, according to Final Draft, is the number one selling screenwriting software in the world. In all seriousness, everybody does use it, so I think they are number one.
So well, I got the trivia. We have trivia. Do we have copies of Final Draft?
We should have copies here.
Yes, so we have three copies of Final Draft we're going to give out based on answers. The first person to correctly answer
the following trivia questions.
Well, I changed the trivia questions.
Different than these?
They're different than those, yep.
Why would you do that?
I didn't think they were that
interesting. You changed my whole presentation. Can I at least ask the first one? Cause it's
no, we're not using those questions.
We're not using those
questions. You can ask this one.
I can ask this one?
It's like Smothers Brothers. But not.
Are you kidding me? You want? That's not true.
Marshall goes in overtime.
Okay.
Sorry. Sorry, Marshall. So
you grabbed the mic.
I forgot what I was going to say.
So for the first copy of Final Draft, tell me, first person answer, who is the first female monster to appear in a movie?
Alien?
The Bride of Frankenstein's correct. Who thinks they said it first?
Elsa Lanchester.
You're supposed to raise your hand. You see, you're not doing this.
We'll give it to that.
You're not doing this. Give me this back. Give me this back.
What film? This is a tough one. All right. What film was the last sequel to win Best Picture?
Raise your hand.
Godfather
2. He said Alien. You said
no. Let's see. It's
Lord of the Rings.
It had there's a lamb in it. Silence of the Lambs. I didn't think you were going to get it. A lot of people don't know this, but Silence of the Lambs was a sequel to Manhunter, 1986 American crime thriller based on Red Dragon, the novel.
You know, that's the one that you told me not to
Michael Mann made it.
That was the one I was going to ask.
Lord of the Rings. Who think? All right, let's give it to Carl. Then, lastly, what screenwriter has received the most Oscar nominations?
William Goldman.
There you go.
Give that man a copy of Final Draft.
Thank you very much.
Okay. And a very quick introduction from Marshall.
That's enough. You don't need it. You did it already.
Thanks.
Amen. Thank you very much.
Very quick introduction from Marshall. Since this whole thing is basically about Marshall's life, we don't really need to. He's pretty much going to introduce himself. But Marshall is a rare breed in Hollywood. He's paved many trails in television with 30-something and with My So-Called Life. And didn't you direct a couple episodes of Family, too, with Christian McNichol?
I did.
Yep. He also produced Traffic and Blood Diamond and a bunch of other films. He's known as a gentleman in Hollywood, which is absolutely often rare. Yep. With that, let's give you a little more.
Thank you, pal. Hi. This is quite a room. I've never been in this room before. If anybody in this front row falls asleep, I'm gonna be really pissed off. But if I were there, I'd be asleep already. So I just want to say that. Okay. You know, there was some nominal organization to what this was about tonight, and I'll try to keep to that, but I'm really happy to sort of go as far afield as anyone wants me to go, so please feel free to interrupt. This notion of the antihero, which I find kind of funny because I think it's been misused a lot. Actually, there's a lot to talk about this. Let me just back up for 1 second. I came out here too many fucking years ago, in the mid-70s, and that was in the time when television was called the Great Wasteland, because it was. And I came out here to be a filmmaker. And I went to AFI to learn how to be a filmmaker. And of course, the first job I got was writing a television show. And I remember sitting with Ed Zwick, who I met at AFI, and we had become friends. And I remember saying to him, listen, I got this job writing a television show, but I'm not going to be brainwashed into thinking that television is good. We know that television is bad and movies are good. And so even though I'm writing a television show, I'm going to remember that television is bad. And then he got a job in television and we had this, you know, this promise together that we would remember that television is bad. And lo and behold, what happened as we got into the industry was there was a big change in movies in the 1980s, not unlike what's happening now, where the great dumbing down of movies, you know, there was about a decade when movies were basically made for teenage boys because they would go to a movie 10 and 20 times. And at the same time, all of a sudden, all this interesting stuff was being done in television for the first time. And I remember the two of us looking at each other and saying, are we being brainwashed or is it really true that somehow movies are getting worse and TV is getting better? All right, so here we are now 30 years later and the same thing has happened. But when we got into television and when we did 30-something, which was the first series that we created, what we wanted to do was bring what we understood about filmmaking to television. And the idea of an antihero had been around since the mid-60s, and if you look in French cinema before. So it was nothing new. It's just no one had seen it on television before. And we didn't even think that we were creating antiheroes, and I wouldn't call our people antiheroes, but people called them that. And I remember when we had the first sort of upfronts for 30-something, and we met the press in Pasadena in 1987 when we were about to go on the air. You know, a lot of people had seen the pilot, like in the business, and people liked it. And, you know, we were generally thinking that this was going to be a good crowd. And instead, all of these journalists started throwing these questions at us. I remember this sort of middle-aged woman said, well, it's clear that the producers of this show don't like children very much. And, you know, I had kids. Ed had kids. We thought we liked our kids. You know, it's like, what do they mean they don't like children very much? And we went, oh, you mean because they complain about them and because they want to go away and have a weekend by themselves and because their marriage is having trouble because they have a kid. And I realized, oh, the idea of ambivalence is utterly unknown to these television critics because it has never existed in television before. It's not like we made it up. It's just it wasn't in television before. So for me, the idea of an antihero is really about someone who's complicated, someone who has differing motives. You know, and I think that's what we've always tried to do in all of our work. What's interesting to me now is that in the last few years, television has, especially cable television, I would say probably probably principally cable television, has devoted itself almost entirely to this kind of nihilistic, destructive, self-destructive, fucked up, you know, troubled main characters. And it's interesting to watch. It's interesting to me because it has shaken up sort of the way things were. It disturbs me sometimes because, you know, it's impossible now to do something that's in some way just nice on television. And I think that's I think that's a loss in some way. We're very aware, for instance, that there's just no way to do the kind of shows we used to do on television now. You know, we pitched a show several times, actually, about a family, and there was no real spin on it. It was just about a family. And, you know, it's the kind of thing we'd always done before. And, you know, the executive we pitched it to in one place, you know, when we were finished, said, can he be a detective? And we did what you did. We started to laugh, which was a mistake, because she was serious. And so that was the end of that deal. But, you know, it is disturbing to me that we've now, you know, the pendulum has swung so far that it's impossible, you know, outside of, well, I won't even talk about broadcast because I think that's a whole other thing. But in cable television, it's almost impossible to talk about someone who isn't utterly and completely damaged and self-destructive in some way. And I wonder where that's going to go. And probably that will run its course as well. But I think the good news is that in the midst of doing this, there's been an acknowledgement in the culture. I mean, people watch this, obviously, and they watch it because it resonates with them. It resonates, I think, what you have is Americans in general having the same experience that I had as a kid watching television in the 1960s and going, either they're crazy or I'm crazy, but I don't live in the same world as these people. I mean, I remember so clearly watching shows like My Three Sons, for instance. You know, the older people here will remember that show. And, you know, it was a classic sitcom, which is to say that one week Chip wants to start his own business and he turns the whole family upside down in order to start the business. And then the next week he's in love with a girl and the business doesn't exist. And in each of these episodes, the behavior becomes so acted out that they are literally insane people. And that was kind of what we used to call television reality. And it's so there was such a disjuncture between that and my experience of life that I actually found it very disturbing to watch. And I feel like, you know, America's sort of got the same feeling now, and in some way they're more comfortable watching these fucked up characters because they go, oh, okay, this resembles my life a little bit more than what used to be there. So, you know, let the pendulum go that way. I just hope it comes back. I think there's a lot more to talk about in the landscape today of both television and movies besides this whole issue of, you know, sort of the anti-hero and the role they play. So, you know, I'm happy to make this a conversation. If people want to jump in and ask me questions, I can. It'll point me in a direction. Yeah.
Marshall.
Yeah.
Do you think that when I remember watching 30-something, I was a teenager, and it was so.
When you were six, yeah.
Yeah, it was. Whatever. And it was. I remember just being really real. My parents think it was really real. Would that show? I don't know if you've watched it in a while. Would it stand up today if we watched it right now?
Well,
and what would be wrong with it if it wouldn't?
Oh boy, that's a good question. Okay, real. Each generation defines real in a different way. That's what the Actors Studio was. That's what Marlon Brando was in the early 50s when these actors came out, you know, and had a different way of acting. People went, "Oh my God, it's so real." You know, and when we look at it now, it doesn't look particularly real. It's still brilliant, but it doesn't look real to us. But in that moment, it seemed real. What's amazing to me is that the great paradox of our business is that we're in the business of fake. Everything we do is fake. It's all illusion. And what we're trying to do is create the illusion of reality. But it's always an illusion. Therefore, it will always break down, you know, to the next generation. So I can tell you, when we were doing 30-something, there were certain key things that we thought were really important. Some of them are still important today, and some of them have been supplanted by other things. But for instance, first of all, we said, these people live in a house that's all messed up because everybody we know with young kids lives in a house that's all messed up. So the props people would have just piles and piles of crap of like laundry and children's toys and all that. And so after we would rehearse a scene, they would go through and they would just crap up the room, just throw shit on the floor and stuff on all the counters and all of that. And that was a big deal in those days because you never saw that on television. There was a whole issue that we had about cinematography on the show. You know, this was a moment, the 1980s was an amazing moment for cinematography. You know, the early 70s was an amazing time, and the late 80s was an amazing time. And there were these changes that were being done, mostly in commercials at that time. And, you know, for instance, you know, they pioneered the idea that when you want to shoot an interior, instead of having all these stupid lights above, as if people had them in their houses and all of that, go and take a bank of, you know, 10Ks outside and blow them on white cards outside the windows and have just this unbelievable amount of light just coming in the windows and don't put anything inside because, duh, that's what happens in people's houses. And you would look at it on film and it was like a miracle. It's like, oh my God, that looks real. And I remember, you know, sort of challenging our cinematographers and saying, I want to look at the dailies and I want to forget that this is a set. I don't want to know that it's a set. And so we would, you know, find ways. I remember the first time our DP, you know, thought of the trick. Of course, it was, again, it was already done in commercials, that not only was the light coming from inside, but he would put these white cards on the floor so it would bounce up at the people. And it was so odd and interesting and looked just like life. So, again, trying to make it look like life, you know, wardrobe. They didn't have an endless supply of wardrobe. They would wear the same things in different shows. But the main part for us was in the writing and the directing. That we used to have this idea, again, this idea of television reality. In television reality, when two people have an argument, it's incredibly well spoken, and one person always wins. And the person who loses is always reduced to silence at the end. And either that person walks out because they're so embarrassed, or the other person walks out because they've had their say and they have nothing else to say and they walk out of the room. And that's how TV arguments always go. And we said to ourselves, you know, have you ever had an argument like that? No fucking way. Have you ever had an argument with your wife like that? Definitely not, okay? And we explored the idea of arguments. And, you know, what's amazing is arguments are spasmodic. You know, they erupt. People talk really fast. And then there's this long silence where everybody's embarrassed and doesn't know what to say. And then people try to make nice, but it doesn't work. And then it gets messed up again. And then you get confused. And then the kid cries and life intervenes. And arguments are messy. So the idea was, how messy could you make an argument on a television show before it begins to break down in some way? Because what you realize is that when you're trying to tell the truth on film, you can only go so far because you are creating an illusion. And we used to joke on 30-something that we were sort of optimal at about 92 octane of truth, and that above 92 octane, it would begin to fall apart. It would actually get boring or distancing, or people couldn't like stay with it, that or it was too painful, like holding a flame over a fire too much. So there is a lot of craft that goes into creating that sense of reality. But we used to talk about that all the time. What is the octane of truth in this scene? How would people actually express themselves? Would they be able to express themselves? You know, how much silence can you have in a scene? And then, of course, the same thing in the directing, that people, it's so important to remember that in life, people always try not to say what they're actually feeling. That's how we are bred, you know, that's how civilization exists, is that they try not to say what's on their mind. And, you know, when they say what's on their mind, it's because they can't do anything else at that point. And so, in some way, creating those obstacles to telling the truth is what conveys that sense of truth. I remember when Ed and I were at AFI, we had a wonderful teacher named Nina Foch, who some of you remember. She was an actress in the 40s and the 50s. And Nina had become a teacher of directors. She worked at USC for a long time after AFI. And she used to talk about, she had something she called idiosyncratic contrapuntal juxtaposition. And I won't spend a half hour trying to define that. But, you know, a lot of that was the idea that truth is often conveyed by the person's attempt not to do the thing that they're doing. Now, the classic example of that is, how do you play drunk? The way you play drunk is the attempt not to be drunk, because that's what drunks do. They try to make themselves okay, all right? That's kind of a cliche by now. But it's actually true about most things. What makes you cry when you watch a movie? What makes you cry is a person starting to cry who's desperately trying not to cry. That's what makes you cry. If a person's just blubbering all over the place, you don't cry as much, because it's the nobility of trying not to cry. And I remember when we were at AFI, there was this moment. Ed used to house sit for Nick Meyer, the novelist. I'm sure you guys have heard him. He's made a bunch of movies as well. He had this great house in Laurel Canyon. And we were sitting there one day at Nick Meyer's pool. It was Ed and me and Ed's girlfriend. And like, you know, people who are 23 years old, we started doing stupid things. And we started trying to fall into the pool seemingly by accident. And you know, was it believable that we were falling in the pool by accident? And, you know, I don't know what it looked like to be watching this. But I remember thinking, wait a minute, what did Nina say? What Nina said was, it's the attempt not to do the thing. So all of a sudden, I started to trip, and then I tried to catch myself, and I kind of spun all around, and I was like in great distress, and I fell in the pool. And they went, oh my God, are you okay? And I completely fooled them, because I tried not to fall into the pool. And so that lesson, of which it's one of 100 lessons that you learn along the way, of what is it that creates verisimilitude? What is it that creates the look of reality? Now, if you look at 30-something now, which I've done, you know, in the last year or two, the clothes are really dated. Actually, the photography is now dated because it's actually stylized. In some ways, the shows are still too nice. You know, it's amazing. You know, we thought we were pushing the envelope, but even now it's too nice. But a lot of it still holds up. And a lot of the dynamics between the people held up for me. And I was really happy about that. And by the way, we did the same thing in My So-Called Life. And the pilot of My So-Called Life still holds up. I just watched it a year ago. And I was kind of amazed, actually. I didn't direct that and I didn't write it, so I can sort of, you know, be completely immodest about it. It holds up amazingly well. It's very pure.
What year was that?
That was 94. That was 94. Claire was 13 when we did it, and she was a genius. So, you know, she scared the shit out of all of us, because she was like this she was like from another planet, you know, like where did that come from? So, but, you know, that, there was a purity in that show, and there was just a sense of, oh, this is what it's like to be that age, that, that still holds up.
You talked about, you know, the, this idea of My Three Sons and how it was completely removed from your personal reality at the time in the 60s and 70s. What was the pivot for you? What show was the first show you saw as a youth, maybe, that said, that spoke to you and said, wow, I relate to this? Was it a show like The Honeymooners? Was it All in the Family? Was it, what kind of show was it that just made you realize, oh, it can be different? Storytelling can be different.
See, the thing was, nothing on television did that. Like, nothing. The Honeymooners, when I was a little boy, was terribly upsetting to me. Really upsetting. And one of the most upsetting thing was they never went anywhere. It was just in that one room. And I kept waiting for them to go somewhere else. Why don't they go somewhere else? It's like they're in prison. You know, there were shows that I liked, but they didn't, you know, I liked The Man from U.N.C.L.E., you know, but it didn't relate to my experience, just to my fantasies. But the point was that I saw it in movies. You know, look, in terms of what I'm talking about, there was Robert Altman, there was Woody Allen. Woody Allen, you know, Woody Allen was the god. You know, Woody Allen's influence on movies and American culture, it's almost impossible to calculate how, what his influence has been. You know, I don't even want to get into how upsetting it is to know about his personal life now, but just as an artist, you know, Annie Hall is such an astonishing piece of work. You look at it, and you have to watch it several times to understand how brilliant it is, because you're just sort of swept up in it. You know, yeah. It's just funny, and it's great, and it's charming, and you laugh, and you know, the level of insight that he has, you know, there are things we still talk about. In fact, we used to say, when we were doing 30-something, we used to say that that Woody Allen was our Arnie Sacknessum. Now, I don't know how many people here will know that particular reference, but Arnie Sacknessum was the Icelandic explorer in Journey to the Center of the Earth, who had gone to the center of the Earth 200 years before. And when the explorers went there, they would keep finding the marks that he left, and that showed them the way to get to the center of the Earth. And we used to say, that was Woody Allen. Everything we thought of that we thought was so fucking brilliant, we would then go, oh shit, Woody did that in Manhattan. You know, he was so incredibly inventive, but also insightful. You know, in Manhattan, you know, Diane Keaton keeps talking about her ex-husband Jeremiah and how incredibly sexual he was, and how dominant he was, and how he opened her up sexually, and how powerful he was. And then you meet him, and it's Wally Shawn. And Woody Allen is like, that's Jeremiah, you know. And Woody, he had seen something in life that I've seen 20 times in my life, that the particular thing that happens with women, happens with men in a different way, but how many times in my life have I seen a woman create a man out of clay almost and think he's so amazing? And he's Wally Shawn. It's like, what the fuck, you know? And the fact that he noticed that, there are 1,000 things he did in his movies like that. And also just the way he picks apart life and what it means to be a man and a woman and relationships, all of that. So, you know, he was doing that in movies. Paul Mazursky was doing something like that in movies. So there were a lot of things in movies that we saw. And you know, so the question was, why can't you do it on television? There was nothing like it on television. Since then, there's been a lot, but at that time, there was nothing. So that was, you know, all we did was take it from here and take it from there and bring it here. So what else?
This forum is meant to be somewhat interactive, so if you have a question that...
Please. Yes.
It's a forum. My question is about, you mentioned how the anti-hero is something that's not necessarily a new device, using storytelling. Something's been around, you know, since the 60s.
so on and so forth. But as contemporary antiheroes, your words have been particularly more fucked up and, you know, evidence an almost shocking display of the disturbing content. And I'm curious what your thoughts on that are in relation to what we face as a global society today, you know, without getting too political about it, but how much you believe it's just the pendulum taking a natural swing to this side of storytelling in that sort of disturbing manner, or if you think it's how much it's related to the economic situation, I guess a relatively unpopular war and, you know, mm-hmm. things of the like that we've faced over the last 5 or 8 years.
Really interesting question. We are a very polarized society right now, in some ways more polarized than you know, in the last 100 years. But we've been polarized before, and there's been a lot of anger in society before. You know, in 1968, I was afraid that we'd have some kind of civil war in America. And, you know, Frank Capra talked about when he made Mr. Smith Goes to Washington in 1939, you know, he was going easy on Congress then and how dysfunctional it was. So it's always been there. You know, I feel like what's happening now, though, is a different thing, which is there's a way in which almost nobody buys into the American myth anymore. And I don't mean the myth of the American dream. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about a different myth. The myth of we're all okay. The myth of everything's fine. Now, in the 1960s, that myth was absolutely dominant in America. And I think one of the reasons why things went crazy in the 1960s was a lot of people were going, wait a minute, this isn't life, this is the way people live, you know, this is all fake, it's not real, you know. And I think then in the 1970s that became more obvious in some way. But I think by now, I don't think there's any segment of society that can look at their lives and say, this is all okay. You know, there's too much that's messed up, you know. And there's a lot of, there's some good in that, but there's a lot bad in that too. I think the fact that no one's upholding the myth anymore means that it's very hard for children in particular to know what to believe in anymore. And I think what you end up is having people who feel hopeless and helpless and scared and cynical and a lot of things. I mean, I think in a way we need myths as a society. We need to believe in a myth, but we don't have one right now. And so this notion of, you know, Shameless or Walter White or, you know, or Dexter, any, you know, that resonates for people because in some way, it's like, why not? Do you know what I mean? Things are pretty fucked up. You know, it's like, it is the natural outgrowth of, oh God, what was his name? The talk shows where everybody would end up in a fist fight.
Jerry Springer.
Yeah, right. Yeah, Jerry Springer. It's sort of the outgrowth of that. It's like people looked at that and said, well, you know, my family's no better. You know what I mean? It's like, you know, that was a fringe audience, but I think it's become more mainstream. You know, the problems with the economy or the inequality in the economy, I know that plays into that. By the way, I need to say this. It's something that's been on my mind a lot lately. That issue very much pertains to us in this business now. And it's very upsetting to me because it's so unnecessary. And I'm sure everyone in this room feels the brunt of it. But what's happened in our business is what's happened all across America, which is the very top level of executives are making 2 and 3 and 4 times what they used to make. And if you do the math, actually, it's pretty extraordinary. If you do the math, the pay scale for the top executives who run Hollywood, you know, I'm guessing that there are maybe 200 to 300 executives who make more than $1 million a year. And of course, the top ones make 60, 50, 40, 50, 60 million a year. But there are tiers below them. You know, there's the $25 million tier, there's the $12 million tier, there's the $7 million tier, the $3 million tier, and the $1 million tier. Okay, that's a lot of tiers. Okay, and if you look at the increase in pay that they've gotten in the last 10 years, I will bet you that that exactly equals the amount of money that's been taken away from the creative community in terms of their fees in the last 10 years. And it has nothing to do with the business being flat, has nothing to do with, you know, lacking new sources of revenue. It's that what's happening across America is the top levels of corporations are taking the money because they can, and there's no one to tell them they can't, so they are. And it has having a huge effect on American life. So this is not, it's not theoretical, it's actually, it directly pertains to our everyday life in this town and your ability to get movies and television shows made and ability to have the budgets that you need and support your families. So that's my soapbox.
That brings up a really interesting point, and it's about the future of the industry as it has been for the last 100 years.
Yeah.
So, you know, you have a lot of the younger creatives moving towards digital.
Yeah.
What are your thoughts on that?
Okay. All right. The internet is killing intellectual property all over the world. Killing it. Okay? The value of intellectual property is plummeting because of the internet. And no one's talking about it. And everyone assumes there's nothing we can do about it. But look at it. Photography, music, publishing, magazine publishing, book publishing, journalism, you know, almost anywhere you look, intellectual property is being devalued. It is partly because of just the inherent effect of the internet, partly from piracy, but they obviously intersect because people want things for free on the internet. So that's where it comes from. We've been spared in our business, but it's happening right in front of us.
What about supply and demand? Do you think that's a factor? That there's so much intellectual property that stuff that used to get really high value.
I actually don't think so. In other words, what I think is that, well, it's complicated. Okay, there's so much, but there's only so much because this avenue was created that allowed so much to happen. Do you know what I mean? But I believe that people are not satisfied by the, in other words, you can't watch amateur videos on YouTube all day. It's not satisfying, okay? There is a role in the culture for professional artistry, whether it's photography, music, whatever it is, okay? There's a role for the professional. And the problem is if a professional can't get paid, then the professional's not gonna be a professional anymore. And what you're gonna have is only the amateur. That's where we're headed in this culture, and it really scares me a lot. So, you know, it's a chicken and egg thing. Do you know what I mean? In other words, there is so much supply, but nevertheless, it's also because it's so hard to get paid for what you do. Now, it doesn't pertain to our business yet, but it's coming. And one of the things that scares me is, well, let me back off for 1 second. We are in this moment where something's happening, which is both a huge opportunity, and it scares the shit out of me. What's happening is what a lot of people have been talking about for 7 years, which is this idea of whatever you want to call it, television over the internet. That's what people have been talking about. It's here now, okay? And it's opening up all of these new distribution channels. And they could be endless, by the way. Now, of course, that's great. Anything that can possibly take the power away from the hegemony that runs the business is a great thing, except the people who are going to make use of that power are just huge companies also. So it's never going to really be democratized. What worries me is that there's this very strong possibility, I think, of in some way having so many avenues for content that the available revenue for any given piece of content reaches the point where it's too low to make something professional. That's where I'm afraid we're going. We're not there yet. Television's making a lot of money. Netflix making a lot of money. Amazon's gonna make a lot of money. We're not there yet, okay? But the combination of piracy and illegal downloads and file sharing and all that with this idea of too many ways to get there. And like, you look at what's happening now with the unbundling, you know, with CBS and HBO, and now everybody's going to be offering their own stuff alone on the internet. In the beginning, that'll make a lot of money, but we don't know where it's going to go. We don't know where any of this stuff is going to go, but we have to keep in mind that there is a minimum required budget for professionally created entertainment. I can't tell you what that budget is. It changes all the time, but you know, it goes to who's the art director, you know, who's the actor, who's the writer, who's the director, how many days did you take to shoot it? These are all things that have a fundamental floor under which you go, and it's not professional anymore. And you know, when we are pushed to make things for less and less and less, eventually you're going to hit that floor. So that worries me. We may never reach it, but I'm scared about it. That's all.
I think it's an excellent point, and you know, the piracy point is absolutely a huge issue that we all need to be cognizant of. I think more the question is, you have a lot of the younger creators who are actually intimidated by Hollywood. And now that they have all these tubes and platforms, now that they have all these outlets and tools and platforms such as YouTube, they are actually just creating their own market, if you will. And there is a lot of creativity. You have, you know, high quality production at very low budget because of the tools that are available to them that's speaking to a particular audience. You know, I'm sure you go on YouTube and look at this stuff, but have you seen things there just from a pure storytelling perspective that you can identify with or say, hey, there's a future here for this particular talent?
Honestly, no. I mean, I'm sure they exist. Well, by the way, there's two problems here.
Yep.
One is, yes, I am prejudiced to believe that it's very hard to create really good content if you don't have training. It's very hard that there's a difference between professional and amateur. A lot of people disagree with that. I understand, but I am old and set in my ways, and that's the way it is. Now, it doesn't mean that every once in a while Orson Welles doesn't come along who doesn't need training. I get that. Do you know what I mean? And there are people with a particular point of view. I'm not saying all that stuff is useless. That's not my point. My point is that in general, and by the way, this has been true for generations. You know, in the 60s, everybody was writing a screenplay.
Yep.
Now, what percentage of those screenplays were any good? A very low percentage, okay? Because that's just in the nature of things. It's just, you know, most people can't do it well. So that's not a knock. It's just saying that, again, you know, if you're going to have this situation where you have thousands and thousands of people creating content in this way, some things are going to bubble up. Yes, that's true. Some things are going to be great, and that's wonderful. I'm just saying, as a system, as a societal system for storytelling, I'm not convinced that it's a great thing. I'm not convinced that it's better than what we had before. I'm not convinced that it serves people's lives. But there is this other problem, which you actually alluded to. I'm not sure you meant to, but it's hard to find, okay? You know, when I first went onto the internet to do a show, there was a moment in time when something could just go viral by itself, and you know, it would be found by a lot of people. And yes, that still happens, but when you have literally 4 hours of content being put onto YouTube every second, you know, and millions and millions and millions of files and titles, it becomes almost impossible to be discovered. And so there's a whole other problem then for how does this stuff bubble up? You know, what are the routes and ways in which this stuff bubbles up, and how could it ever be fair? So that's a whole other situation, which, by the way, is mirrored to a lesser extent in our business, which is to say that it's now so hard for everything to be found.
You know, I think.
What's that?
Social media is how you find it.
Well, yes and no. I mean, I think the people that run the studios and the networks are pretty frustrated with social media. It works when it works, and it really doesn't work when it doesn't work. And they, you know, they're still trying to figure it out.
Works great for viral, though, and for people who aren't in the studios.
Yes, it's great for viral. sometimes of certain kinds of things. I honestly don't think that it's the answer to what we need. I think that it creates its own problems in that way. Yes, in the back.
Totally different topic. I think it's 30-something.
Speak up a little.
Sure. The way we handle narrative in television series has changed enormously in the last 20 years. fewer closed-end series, except for maybe different seasons. You're now telling stories, either closed-end series, 6-10 episodes, or an entire season where you're following an arc. And I wonder if you had any thoughts about the changing nature of storytelling in that environment.
That's a great question.
I love this change. I love this change. I think it has directly led to incredible work being done on television. And I think that it's, you know, the interesting thing is it's a change that's in line with great art of the past. I mean, it's no different from what Dickens did. You know, this idea of serialized storytelling over time opens up avenues to talk about how people's lives change and how people change over time, how situations change. It's novelistic in that way. And for me, as a creator, it's been incredibly freeing. I really love it. And I think that the box we were pushed into for so many years in television, which is to say, you know, that same chip problem, which is, it's only in this episode, pal. Nothing comes out of this episode that changes these people's lives, was really problematic. So I'm really happy about it. I hope people don't get tired of it, but, you know, we'll see. Yes, a lot of questions. Yeah, go ahead.
Please forgive my ignorance, but have you ever written a novel, or have you thought about writing a novel?
Have I ever written a novel?
Yes.
I always thought that when you write a screenplay, there's still a lot of white space left on the page, whereas on a novel, you have to fill it all up with words. That always scared the crap out of me. No, honestly, I've been too intimidated. I would like to write a novel, but I don't consider myself enough of a reader anymore. You know, and by the way, that's wrong, because it shouldn't matter what other people are writing anyway. But I think there'll come a moment when I can actually like not work as hard as I'm working right now, and probably I'll try to write a novel at that point. So thank you for making me anxious, but yeah, good question. Okay, yes. Yeah.
Getting back to the whole viral videos and YouTube and things like that.
Yeah.
Well, your series Quarter Life started off as a web series, is that correct?
Yes, it did.
And then it transitioned to network.
Yeah, so, for one night.
Yeah. I'm just really curious about, since you've already experienced that world, what that transition was like, and you know what ups and downs you had with that.
Well. You know, I'm going to spend a minute on this because to do justice to it, I would have to spend a long time because there was a lot, you know, worth talking about what I learned, but a lot of things have changed since then. Let me just say that the series was very, very successful online for its time, but our home was on MySpace. And we were promoted on MySpace, but nowhere else. And a good example was, we had a big following, okay? After three or four episodes had aired, YouTube promoted us on the top. And we got like a million hits on that episode. And then they stopped promoting us, and it just went right down again. Now you could say, well, I guess your show wasn't the kind of show that's going to be viral. And the answer to that is, yep, probably wasn't the kind of show that's going to be viral, which is sort of my argument, which is that if things can only succeed because they go viral, it's only going to be certain types of things. And it doesn't necessarily correlate to the things that people are going to find most satisfying in their experiences of watching content. It's possible that Lawrence of Arabia wouldn't have gone viral either in his 4 hours. Not that I'm comparing myself. I don't mean that. But what I'm saying is, all right. So that was one. Two. After I had made the pilot of this thing that was supposed to be on the web, Ben Silverman, who had been hired to run NBC but wasn't there yet, saw the pilot and he said, "I'm going to put that show on NBC. That should be on TV." And I went, "Oh, great." I didn't believe him. Then he goes into the job, And he calls me his first week. He says, we're putting your show on the air. We're buying 6 hours of it. And so they paid us the money. And by the way, everything about this was different. We did these shows for half, less than half of any network show in history. And we did them fine. And they had their life online. And then we're coming up toward the premiere. It was in February on NBC. And as the premiere is approaching, I start to get this sinking feeling, because I realized I'd been in TV a long time. I kind of just had a sense of what people would watch on television. And I realized that we weren't going to be nearly enough for NBC. NBC in those days needed 8 or 9 million viewers for a show to succeed. Now it's probably 4 or 5. I don't know what. Okay. But they needed between 8 and 9 million. And I called Ben a week before we premiered, and I said, we're not going to do it for you. And he said, shut up. And I said, no, I'm telling you, we're going to give you between 3 and 4 million viewers. I don't know why, I just know it. He said, I said, I don't want to hear this. It's going to be great, blah, 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 blah. And sure enough, the premiere had 3.7 million viewers. Okay, now, all right, 3.7 million viewers was the lowest number for NBC in that time slot in 17 years, and we were booted off the air after one night. Okay, all right. However, 3.7 million viewers would at that moment have made it the highest rated cable show in America if it had been on cable, okay? This is 2007, do you know what I mean? We all know this stuff now. Things have changed a lot. In 2007, even Ben didn't really get it. None of us really got it. We didn't really understand that there was an entirely different world on cable, that you were talking about really an entirely different business model on cable. And I called him and I said, put this fucking thing on cable. It'll be, you know, just like, you know, just swallow the losses here and put it on cable. And, you know, Jeff Zucker, bless his heart, was running NBC at that time, as well as he's running CNN right now, if anybody watches CNN. And Jeff Zucker was more interested in avoiding embarrassment than anything else. And so they killed it. They just buried it. So I maintain to this day that we would have been fine on cable. So, you know, it was just one of those things. I mean, you know, to me it was a crushing defeat. People were very nice and said you were ahead of your time. I don't even think I was ahead of my time. I think I was on the wrong network. But that's, you know, that's that. But the point is, I learned a lot about the internet in 2007. It's all changed by now anyway. But I did learn it's really hard. It's really hard to get seen. Really hard to get seen. And this idea that the good stuff rises and becomes viral is not, it's true for the good stuff that rises and becomes viral. But there are 1,000 other good things that should rise that aren't, or 1 million other good things that should rise that aren't. So it's not actually a great system, and we need a better one.
You know, the question is, did we get kickback from the network because it was so progressive and daring? I think we got kicked in the head by the network because of that. I think the network just could not figure out what to do with that show.
They didn't give us a hard time about it. I mean, they were a little scared of Ricky, the character of Ricky, who was sort of indeterminate. I mean, he was sort of vaguely trans, you know. But they just, you have to understand, things have so profoundly changed since then that in 1994, teenage girls were absolutely invisible in American culture. They had no voice. There were no commercials with them. There was nothing. They were just didn't exist. And in fact, you know, when they were talking about canceling the show, Ed and I called Bob Iger, who was running the network at that time, and we said to Bob, literally, we said, Bob, we know that you're making a profit on the show. So this is not a, you're not losing money on the show. You wish you had a higher audience, we understand. But we think that you should keep the show on the air as corporate good works, because you're giving a voice to teenage girls who have no other voice in the culture. That's literally what we said to him. Awesome. And then after the show went off the air, you know, a year later, Claire and Leonardo are in Romeo and Juliet, which is a big hit, And all of a sudden, just like that, the wheel turned. And all of a sudden, Buffy and, you know, a thousand things, and all of a sudden, advertisers, you know, just were all over the idea of we got to reach teenage girls. But that happened so quickly and after we did our show. So that was the thing. It was really just for them, it was all about, you know, where they were as a network and the fact that they that this show, they couldn't figure out what it was for. They didn't understand, by the way, that this show was for grown-ups too. You know, so they just didn't even know how to sell it. So it was sad for us, you know. But in retrospect, I'm secretly glad we only did 19 episodes. I feel like, I remember when we looked at the pilot recently, I said to Winnie, I said, I feel like my so-called life is the James Dean of television shows. And it was probably better that James Dean died at 23 and didn't become a paunchy 60-year-old guy. So at any rate. Okay, who else who hasn't asked a question here? I can't really see very well. Okay, Imbe, go ahead.
So the way that House of Cards is portrayed is that a new group of chance-taking executives at a company called Netflix said, let's give David Fincher and Kevin Spacey and whoever else the main prime movers were $100 million and roll the dice and see if we can get $400 million back or whatever in new subscribers and keeping our churn low for subscribers. And then the network seemed to respond by saying to people like Vince Gilligan and hopefully to you and to other people.
Not to me, but go on.
I'm sorry. Yeah. I really am, because they should have.
And what did they say in response?
They
go ahead.
Said, all right, so here's, you know, Vince, you wrote this Battle Creek thing. You're at CBS. We're going to give you 13 episodes. We're paying for all of them, and you're going to shoot them all. And all these other creators, and the idea was now make the big bet, because the response could be so huge that singles and doubles are, you know, the baseball analogy. They don't matter, and home runs are all that matter in the very short life cycles of the television executivists, spiderists, the sort of the people that run the networks, that they're going to be out if they don't have hits. It's a hit-driven business. And so they're throwing big punches now. And House of Cards seems to be the first in that set of circumstances from where I sit. So uh-huh. I'm fascinated for you, who looks to have decades left in you to do stuff, when you are monitoring the scene as a person who has extraordinary credentials enough to fill rooms larger than this with people wanting to hear what you have to say, how do you assess the way the wind blows, and how do you position yourself to catch okay. that wind in meaningful ways going forward?
Okay.
And that may instruct all of us in how we conduct ourselves moving forward too.
Well,
it's also referring to the day and date concept too. You talk about episodic and stretched over
right.
weeks.
Right. Okay. What I would say is, first of all, the idea of the big bet in television, I'm not totally convinced that that's what's going on. It certainly is going on, but is it becoming dominant? I'm not convinced of that. I'll tell you why. First of all, I will say that I think that's killed the movie business. So let's be clear about that. In television, they need too much product, okay? They've got to fill the airwaves. So, you know, they need those programmers. They just need them. That's the reality. Their bread and butter is these, you know, all these different shows they put on all the time. I'm not saying they're not going after these big bets, but I don't think it's going to have the same kind of dominant power that it's, you know, come to have in the film business. At least I hope not. But the other thing is, unlike the film business, I think they are taking chances. I think your description of Netflix is mostly true. I think, you know, they have this whole algorithm thing they use in terms of predicting, you know, whether they're going to reach their subscribers. And I, by the way, I've run into that and not made a sale there because they put the numbers in, you know, with the comps of what they thought my show, you know, what the other Netflix thing rentals are and that sort of thing, and they found it wasn't worth it. So they weren't just being bold and brave. They were also just using a different predictive model. But nevertheless, they took a big chance, and I applaud them for that. And I do think that their willingness to do that has been influential in a good way, because I hear executives talk about this now. I mean, I think, you know, there's another way to spin what you said, which is that in a lot of these different corporate buildings, they're looking at each other saying, shit, we have to take some risks. We have to try something different, because the same old isn't working terribly well. So the idea of taking risks and trying a different thing is okay, as long as it doesn't all have to be $100 million plays. And they're not, I guarantee you they're not, because I've run into it. They're holding the purse strings very, very tightly at all of the networks, with a few exceptions. So, what else? Yeah.
I want to talk about traffic for a quick second.
Yeah.
There used to be a trend where films would then be adapted to TV.
Yes.
And Traffic was a film that was actually adapted from a television show.
Yes.
Do you see more of that happening, just like YouTube, or let's call them, I don't like to use the word YouTube, but online content, mm-hmm. as you had with your experience with your program, then turn into a television show?
Right.
How much more do you see this cross-platform storytelling world existing? Because I'm of the belief that you need to tell stories that are respecting the individual platform. So what's
right.
that transition like from one to the other from a producer perspective?
Well, I think the landscape in movies has been utterly contaminated by the fact that they don't want to make a movie anymore that isn't already known in the culture. They don't want to create the brand for the movie, because they feel like they can't do it. So it has to either be an existing TV show, an old movie remake, a sequel, a famous book, that sort of thing. And I think, again, that's ruined the movie business, because they've created the box that they're in right now, because of their whole way of distributing and marketing films, starting in 1976, by orienting toward the opening night. This situation became inevitable. It just took a long time to come about. But in television, I still think that story is king. I really do. I think mostly in television, you know, they each have their brand, they're each trying to figure out, but basically they're trying to sell stories, narrative, that people are going to be interested in, and they don't give a good goddamn where it comes from. It could be a movie, it could be, you know, it could be an old TV show, it could be something somebody thinks of, but, you know, this notion, you know, in the Producers Guild, you know, people talk about pitching, you know, that you should learn how to pitch. And it's like, well, anybody in the movie world doesn't have to know how to pitch anymore, because you can't sell anything by a pitch anymore. But in the TV business, you can still sell by a pitch. You can come up with a story you made up and go into a room, tell them the story, and make a sale. So that's the good part of the TV business, that they are interested in stories. So,
Marshall, when you were talking about, when you gave that note about 92% octane is the right octane, that actually too much truth is not believable and not watchable, and you talked about not falling in the pool is the mechanism, or conversation, the silence in arguments, but that stuff is mind-blowing. I think we can all use to make better content. Can you share some more examples like that with maybe in your movie experience, maybe in The Last Samurai or Traffic or other TV where we can kind of learn about mechanisms?
Personal stories of your own work where you've used those devices and
uh-huh.
as a mechanism to be successful?
It's a good question, but let me think about it for a minute.
Say what it was like working with Tom Cruise.
You know what?
Don Cheadle.
It was great working with Tom Cruise. That's the truth. Tom Cruise was a great guy to work with. Who was it? Somebody said about Tom that when you work with Tom, he shows up on the set every morning and says, "How can I make your dreams come true today?" And that is the truth. That's
says that?
Yeah. Well, that's how he. That's every ounce of his being is oriented toward that. No, he was totally great to work with, and utterly friendly and kind to everyone on the set. I remember when we went to New Zealand, when we had been there a week, there was an article in the local paper saying that everyone on the production had to sign an agreement that they wouldn't look Tom in the eye, that they wouldn't make eye contact with Tom. And I looked at that and I thought, Jesus, you know, maybe that's never been true. Because you've heard that story over the years, times, you know, that this or that actor has said that. And I suddenly thought, maybe it's never been true. Because it certainly couldn't be less true about Tom. So, okay, I'll give you one about 92 Octane Truth. The final battle in The Last Samurai, which is a long time ago, you may not remember, but basically it was hand-to-hand combat between, you know, what was essentially 500 samurai and, you know, several thousand troops of the Japanese emperor. And we had 500 trained fighters who we had brought from Japan. And we had, you know, brought them to New Zealand and they had been living there. And we had a stunt coordinator who set up this final battle. And the way you do these battles on film, usually, is each person is taught a fight that has four moves that loops around. So that, you know, this, there's a parry, then the guy comes down, and then it repeats again and again and again, and it can keep going on. Well, we didn't really know what this guy was doing, but he didn't like that because he didn't think it was real. He said, I'm going to make a battle that looks real. So he broke up all the 500 guys into four groups, and he taught each of the four groups this incredibly elaborate fight sequence that had 22 moves in it. Wow. And they were amazing to watch. Okay. And so the morning comes and we're going to do this battle. And I don't know if you've ever been in a situation like this. It is so unbelievable because everything looks real. You know, you're up on this platform and you've got literally 13 cameras going and everybody's adrenaline is going and you've got literally, there are 250 guys over there and 250 guys over there and they're going to run at each other full tilt and they're going to fight. And you don't know what the fuck is going to happen. Are people going to die? I mean, they've been training for weeks for this. They know what to do, but you don't know what's going to happen. And it utterly looks real. And, you know, everything, it's like, the minutes and the hours go by. And finally, we're there. And everything is all set. The cameras are running. And Ed yells, action. And the two armies, you know, come at each other. And it was incredible. And we're like punching each other, shaking each other, watching. This is the most amazing thing we ever saw. And after 17 seconds, it just petered out to nothing because they had used up all 22 of their moves in 17 seconds. Wow. And everyone then just stood around. What?
Great 17 seconds.
Oh, my God. And then you watch. It was literally, I can't. It's like you watch, you go, oh, my God, what's happening? Oh, my God. And because then people go from this ferocity to, well, what should I do now? Should I look in the camera? And everyone's just standing around. And that's when we learned what the guy had done and what an utter disaster it was. And we had to shut down. We had to stop shooting for 2 days while he trained everybody in the old four moves that he didn't like because they didn't look real enough because, you know, this battle sequence wasn't going to work at 17 seconds. So sometimes, you know, less truth is better.
It's an amazing story.
Can you share some other, like, clusterfucks that you've worked your way through?
Oh, my God, there have been so many.
Any of those 17 seconds ended up in the final.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Oh, sure. Sure, we had a couple of good shots there, but we needed about another, you know, 84 seconds to make it work.
So if you had six more moves, it would have been all right.
I don't know. There have been so many clusterfucks. I mean, every movie you make falls apart, you know, several times, and that's just par for the course, you know.
How about another way to say it? What was something that surprised you, that came out of the creative process that will always be with you as a memory? It's one of those special moments for you.
That's a good one. I mean, when we did Legends of the Fall, we had a really interesting time with Brad, who was, you know, in many ways, it was his first real starring role in a movie. And he had a lot of strong ideas about how he wanted to play the character. And we disagreed with them. I don't know how many of you remember the movie, but he was playing a guy named Tristan who was sort of a primitive, who was in some way wild. And to us and to Jim Harrison, the author of the novella, that meant he was quite passionate and he was ruled by passion. And Brad had this notion that he was more sort of quiet and internal. And I used to say, the Marlboro Man. And he would say, yeah, like the Marlboro Man. And I said, Brad, in the book, Tristan lives to be 87 years old and is killed by a bear, okay? The Marlboro Man is dead at 58 of lung cancer. You know, they don't, it's not the same person, you know, and, you know, and we, you know, we had a lot of, it was a really interesting process. By the way, totally great guy, completely great guy, but there were a lot of disagreements about playing the part. And there was a moment, I was in Los Angeles, they were filming in near Calgary, and the head of the studio called me in my office, and he said, get on a plane. I said, why? He said, Brad just walked off the set. And, you know, apparently Ed and Brad had gotten into a fight about a scene, and Brad had walked off the set. So I, you know, got the first plane up there. And of course, you know, I get there, you know, that night, like 7 hours later. And of course, by then, Brad had already come back to the set and they were working, they worked the rest of the day. But it was, that was that was the climax of that. And, you know, it was interesting as a producer that was a moment where I had to step in because Ed and Brad were just at loggerheads with each other. And so that was a moment where I had to step in and sit with him and say the things that needed to be said. And what I said to him at that time was, luckily, came out of my training as a director. And as again, goes back to what things, the type of things that Nina taught us. What I said to him was, Brad, look, it's in the script that you kill people with your bare hands and you scalp Germans, you know, and you run off and you know and go to sea for 7 years. That's in the script. You don't have to play that because that's what the character is. Because it's there in the script, you're free to play all these other colors. You don't have to just play those colors. That's going to be true even if you play these other things. And that, by the way, that was the thing that got through. It's funny, he mentioned it to me years later. It was one of the, for me, one of my happiest moments in this business was that, whatever it was, 7, 8 years later, I ran into Brad at a party, and he recounted that conversation to me and said that that had stuck with him, that he had actually learned something from that. And of course, at that moment, I was just trying to figure out whatever I could say that could, you know, that could solve the problem. But it came out of the things that I had learned about how you tell a story. There was another moment like that. Yeah, go ahead. I'll tell you the other moment. Go ahead.
I have a really broad question, which is, you know, an HBO exec once said they have a very simple litmus test for whether to make a show or not, and it's, is it an undeniable character or is it an undeniable world? So my question is, what do you think are the elements of an undeniable character in television?
What does that mean, undeniable character? What does that mean?
Compelling.
Compelling? Uh-huh.
We're talking about the anti-hero, and I'm sure that is the paradigm.
Right.
Because Vince Gilligan says they wouldn't make that show today.
Right.
Right?
Right.
Is it just, oh, you know, someone has a secret, someone has a disorder, you know, plug them into a plot? You know, what do you think that is in television today?
Something primal. That's what I would say. In other words, and I think about this a lot now in the things I'm trying to come up with, that something primal or primitive making itself manifest in the person so that it's a power from inside. And it can come out in all sorts of different ways, but it's some passion, something that's ungovernable, something that takes the person over, something that attacks the person, something that obsesses the person, but it's that force You know, I think there is some, that we want to see some inner power in people, even if it's negative right now. And there are a thousand ways that can manifest itself. But you know, that's what I look for now, is what makes something compelling is that there's something coming from deep inside that person that can't be denied. Yes?
Are there any, can you tell us three books or movies that they have affected you in your way of storytelling or have inspired you?
Yes, okay. Well, unfortunately and embarrassingly, number one is It's a Wonderful Life, which is, as far as I'm concerned, far and away the best movie ever made, and there's no competition. And I could talk for 3 hours about why. If you look at It's a Wonderful Life, I think, first of all, thematically, it's all about ambivalence. In other words, this is a man, it paints a believable picture of a man whose life has been sacrificed and thrown away and he's unhappy, and then all of a sudden just turns around and says, oh my God, he's had an amazing life, okay? And it's believable, all right? Also, in that film, I once counted it, I think there were 11 different stories that are set up around George Bailey's life, and then in the last 20 minutes, when he doesn't exist, literally in 2 seconds, you immediately understand the significance of the fact that he didn't live to those 11 different stories. From a storytelling, from a screenwriting standpoint, it's the most amazing achievement in history. It also has, to me, the most amazing scene I've ever seen that defies all analysis and sort of picking apart, and that's the scene where George and Mary are on the telephone when he comes over to her house, and Sam Wainwright calls from New York and says, put Sam on the phone, and the two of them, I don't even remember this scene, where they're right next to the telephone. And the point is, talk about ambivalence. This is a guy who only wants to leave Bedford Falls. That's all he wants to do. But the problem is he's in love with this girl. But because he wants to leave, he hates this girl right now because he hates the fact that he loves her, okay? And he's stuck on the phone with her, and they're getting closer and closer, and he's smelling her hair, and you know, and he's irresistibly drawn to her. And the moment comes where he throws the telephone down and he grabs her, and by the way, he grabs her, and he's so violent. It's like, this is not a 1940s movie anymore. You listen to me. I don't want any ground floors. I don't want to get married ever. And she's crying and he's shaking her, okay? Boom, you cut to they're married. All right, if you look at that scene, there's no coverage. There's no coverage on Jimmy Stewart. You never see his face during that, through the whole scene. By the way, you have a two shot of the two of them, okay? And you have her crying when he's shaking her. He never shot this, or he never used it, whatever it was, okay? He would have been fired by every network as a director for not getting that shot, okay? It's still the best scene ever done. And in terms of theories of acting, you know, it confounds everything. What was his action? What was his intention? What was the obstacle? Was the action to marry her, or was the action to leave? What's the obstacle? It's an amazing, amazing scene. And that is, so much in that film has influenced me, his sense of humor in that film. The fact, there are things in that film that are never discussed. The fact that Uncle Billy has animals. He has a squirrel, a chipmunk crawling up his arm, and they've got two crows, and he's got all this stuff. They don't even talk about it, okay? You know, the sexuality in it, the throwaways. It's an unbelievable sort of achievement of storytelling. And really speaks to, for me, it really speaks to what it means to be a man in American culture, by the way. And by the way, women too, it's just my experiences as a man. But the point is that what they were saying was that in order to live this life, you have to give up all of your dreams and you have to feel really shitty about it. And that's the truth. And none of that's gonna come back, okay? It's gonna feel really shitty. But you're going to get all this great stuff in return if you're open to it. Dark, really dark. So I used up all the time with that. I would say Annie Hall's the other movie. So.
Is that how you came out with Bedford Falls?
Bedford Falls, yes. Yeah, we named our company Bedford Falls after the town, and it's a wonderful life.
After the town, yeah.
All right, we probably have to wrap up. Go ahead.
I'd love to know who some of your favorite, or maybe the favorite, female character in film or television that sort of stayed with you your whole life, or today's
impacted you. Oh, boy, that's a good question. You know who I really like is this woman, Katrina Balf, on Outlander. I think she's terrific. If you haven't seen the show, it's really good, really worth watching. It has some things that are a little bit silly in the premise, but they do amazing stuff on the show, really interesting stuff. There are two episodes in particular that are almost like one-act plays, really remarkable. And by the way, there's an episode called The Wedding, or Wedding Night, I think it's The Wedding, where she marries this guy, but I don't need to go into the whole story. But it is the most sexual, sensual, erotic thing I've ever seen on television. Really remarkable. Really remarkable filmmaking and storytelling. I really recommend it. That's really good. Female characters. I thought Erin Brockovich was great. I thought she was great in it. I thought that was a really interesting moment in the culture. To talk about a woman who basically says, fuck you, this is the way I dress, I don't care. In other words, the willingness to break out of a box. And by the way, you know, I made a movie called Dangerous Beauty back in the 90s that was very much about that, about a courtesan in Venice in the 1500s, and the idea that, you know, that you can't divorce sexuality from the rest of life is very important to me. So I felt that Erin Brockovich had a similar theme. I'm sure I'll think of 27 things after I leave, but you know, certainly that's changed in the culture for sure in the last 10, 15 years. One more question and we'll wrap it up. Anybody?
You seem like you have like a renewed passion with every question. And as a young producer and filmmaker, I'm curious, what's your well? You know, what do you go back to, and is there a habit, like a habit that you have picked up along the way that helps you stay sharp, stay fresh, stay focused, and really love what you do?
God, that's a good
Don't
question.
Don't say ginkgo biloba.
That's such a good question. You know what? It is a calling for me, and. I remember when it became a calling. I was actually in college, and I was studying Old English, and I was reading these epic poems, you know, Sir Gawain and the Green Knight and Beowulf, and I suddenly realized that I wanted to make movies of them. And in that moment, it just became so important to me that I somehow translate this stuff into film as a form of experience. Of course, I never have, but, you know, it drove me. This idea of storytelling, the idea of moving people. You know, we've always felt that the shows we've done, for instance, My So-Called Life, there are different ways to describe success. You know, there's breadth, which is how many people, how wide is your audience, how many people are watching, and there's depth, which is to say, how moved is your audience. Now, the best of all would be if it's the biggest audience in the world and they're all killed by it, okay? But if I have to choose, I'd rather have a smaller audience and move them really deeply. That's the choice I've made in my career, and I'm happy with that choice. Other people make different choices. But to me, it all comes out of passion. I am passionate. I want people to be passionate about what I do. I want to give them an experience. That what I have valued most in what I've seen in my life is what I experienced the deepest. That's why, you know, It's a Wonderful Life is so important to me, because I had such a powerful experience watching it. That's what I want to give to people. And so that's what drives me. So thank you.
Okay. All right.
Thank you, guys.